Hare Krishna. So today morning, I'll discuss on the topic of appreciating the nuances in communication. So in discussion, here the topic is going on is that Daksha has provoked Lord Shiva and great danger is about to befall him. And in that context, the word Mahatma is used to describe Daksha. So now, the Acharyas are commenting on what does the word Mahatma refer to. So as was mentioned that the word Mahatma, here Viraghavacharya says that he was so steady that even when his own daughter was killing himself, he was not disturbed. And the Acharya said that actually, this Mahatma is used sarcastically. Now, what kind of great soul is this that he offends a great soul? He's not actually a great soul, although some people might consider him to be a great soul. So I'll talk about this specific past incident, but more I'll talk about three broad points that how the context, the tone and the usage and the word usage all can convey a meaning different from the direct meaning. Normally, Srila Prabhupada was not very favorable to indirect interpretations. But it is understood within Mimamsa that especially Mimamsa is concerned with interpretations. So that we have to always look at what a sentence means and whether it makes sense. So for example, if we say that they had a river on the house. Sorry, they had a house on the river. Now, a house cannot be on the river. That means the house is on the banks of the river. This is a straightforward example. Now if we consider, I can easily think about at least 3 to 5 very common contexts in the Bhagavad Gita where the words do not mean what they literally mean. One example is Yanisha Sarvabhutanam Tasyam Jagrati Sanyam Yasyam Jagrati Bhutani Sanisha Pashyatomune. That which is night for all living beings is day for the self-realized, and that which is night for the self-realized is day for all living beings. Now, if we consider day and night as markers of time, they don't change for everyone. And that is the normal straightforward meaning of those words. But that is not the meaning that is used over here. Here, a day refers to the time of perception and the time of action, or the area of perception and the area of action. So Prabhupada makes it very clear in the purport that materialistic people in general are materialistic and they are interested in sensual activities. So that is their area of action and perception. That's what they see clearly, that's what they want to act energetically. But that is the period of lack of perception and lack of action, or we could say lack of interest and lack of action. Spiritualists are not interested in that. So this is an example of non-literal meaning. The literal will make no sense. Similarly, in that same second chapter itself, Sita Pragyasya Ka Bhasha Samadhistasya Keshava Siddhi Kim Prabhasheta Kim Asita Vrajeta Kim. So how does the self-realized person speak? How does the person talk? How does the person walk? How does the person sit? And now, a self-realized person is not a fashion model. Isn't it? So how does the person sit? How does the person walk? That's another defining characteristic of self-realized person. So here, Asita and Vrajet, how does a person sit and how does a person walk, refers not physically sitting and walking. It refers to how the person, sitting refers to the karmen, the indriyas being inactive. That means how does one restrain the senses? And walking refers to the senses being active. So how does one engage the senses? Similarly, later on we see that there is Trividham Narkasyedam Dwaram Nashanam Atmanah. Three gates to hell, they destroy the soul. Now, fundamental teaching of the Bhagavad Gita is Avinashitu Tadvidhi. The soul is never destroyed. And Atmaha, that comes also in the Ishopanishad. Actually, in the 16th chapter, twice Krishna uses this word that Dwaram Nashanam Atmanah, he comes, and this is 16.21. And before that, in 16.9, he says, Etam Drishtim Avashtabhya. Nashtatmano alpa buddhayaha nashtatmano. That they destroy the soul. Now here the word soul and destruction are used in a non-literal sense. They're saying that means one's spirituality, one's spiritual ability to pursue spiritual reality one's spiritual faculty, that gets deadened. When one lives, either it can happen because of either desires or doubts. Desires come from the mind, doubts come from the intelligence, and both of them can block the soul. So first 16.9, Krishna is talking about how doubt, the materialistic worldview, can, the atheistic worldview can completely cover over one's spiritual intelligence. And similarly, he talks about how the materialistic desires, lust, anger, greed, can cover over a person's spirituality. So either way, the person just doesn't perceive anything properly. And especially when one starts using the intelligence to rationalize what one is doing, then it becomes very difficult for such a person to come out of that illusion. So some people are lazy, but they will never admit that they are lazy. I am in a power saving mode. Okay, it's good to save power, but you save power for some purpose, isn't it? Say, if you want to make some important phone calls and we don't have enough charge, we put our phone in the power saving mode. But after power saving is not an end in itself. Power saving is a tool by which we can use the power for something else. But lazy people, they don't use their power for anything. So when the intelligence starts justifying things, then it's much more dangerous. So in that sense, materialistic desires are not as dangerous as materialistic ideologies. Because materialistic ideologies, they subvert the intelligence itself. But anyway, the broad point is through these three examples in the Gita itself, and there are dozens and dozens of examples in the Bhagavatam, which you could go into. The point is that the literal usage does not necessarily convey the actual meaning. And if we look at our own communication, we often use metaphors. Metaphors are implied comparisons. Say for example, he walks like a king. Here there is an explicit comparison. He walks like a king. There the one, the like means this is compared to this. So this is an implied comparison. This is called a simile. So this is an explicit comparison. It's called a simile. And when the comparison is implied, it is called a metaphor. Now time is money. Now literally time and money are not the same. They're two very different things. But whenever some implicit comparison is done, the idea over there is that to understand that comparison, we have to actually see what is the essential point that is being said over there. So what is the basis of the comparison? That on that point, the two of them are equal. So if we understand that, then the comparison starts making sense. Otherwise, the comparison doesn't make sense. So the literal attributes don't. So for example, if somebody says, so people sometimes take a perverted interest, or like a, they sometimes perversely stress something else. So now is not the time to make jokes. So somebody is having a serious discussion, somebody starts becoming frivolous. Now is not the time to make jokes. Other person says, then when is the time to make jokes? The whole point is lost. Then they say that the point is be serious right now, not ask when to be frivolous. So sometimes the stress of the communication, if it is not understood, then people can take some other meaning entirely from it. So if you consider the word Mahatma itself, its literal usage doesn't make sense. The Atma is described as Anu, Keshagra Shatabhagasya Shatadha Kalpitasya Cha. Now, even that description is also not literal. Because if you say that the soul is 1/10,000 the tip of a hair, now how do you quantify a tip of a hair? Is it this much or is it this much? Is it 1 mm or is it 10 mm or is it 0.1 mm? So, how do you quantify in one sense, there is great precision, 1/10,000. But the number of which we are talking about 1/10,000, that is not very precise. So what does it mean? It means essentially that the soul is very small, extremely small. So, but anyway, whatever the specific dimension of the soul, the point of the soul is very small. So the soul is, and the Atma is Anu. Then how can the Atma be Mahan? How can that soul be great? So here, the greatness refers not in size, but in disposition, but in consciousness. that the greatness is that the soul is having, living according to great values. The soul is conscious of great things. And ultimately the soul is conscious of the supremely great thing, that is Krishna. It's interesting that Krishna refers to devotees as Mahatmas in the Bhagavad Gita. Mahatmanastu mam paatha daivim prakritim ashrita. The word Mahatma comes twice in the Bhagavad Gita in Krishna's speech, primarily twice. Once he says, Bahunam janmanamante gyanavan mam prapadyate vasudeva sarvamiti sa mahatma sudurlabha. So those who are surrendered to Krishna, such souls, understanding Krishna to be everything, they are very rare. This is 7.19. And then, after that, again in 9.13 and 14, when Krishna talks about the great souls, he says that 9.13, Mahatmanastu mam partha daivim prakriti mashitaha. Now, interestingly, after talking about the devotees as Mahatma, at the end of the Bhagavad Gita, Sanjay also uses the word Mahatma. He says, Ityaham Vasudevasya Parthasya cha Mahatmanaha Samvadamim Ashrausham Adbhutam Romaharishanam. In this way, I have heard the conversation between the great souls, Mahatmas. Ityaham Vasudevasya Parthasya cha Mahatma. The conversation between, the dialogue between Vasudev and Partha. Mahatmanaha, both of them are Mahatmas. Now, literally we could say Krishna is the supreme being and he is Mahatma. And Arjun, because in the previous verses he has surrendered to Krishna, he is a devotee of Krishna, and Krishna has said the devoted are also Mahatmas. So therefore he is using the usage over there. But the Mahatma, most of the time when it is used to refer to a particular soul, it is not in terms of size, but in terms of conception, of disposition, of values, of consciousness. So those who are Mahatma, those who are great souls, are ones who are devoted to great values. And the greatest value is the Supreme Being, Krishna. Now, there are on the spiritual path two visions of greatness. We could say one is, the vision of greatness comes from detachment from material things. Somebody is very detached from material things, that person may be considered to be great. But that is the we could say material conception of greatness. At one level, a material concept, if somebody possesses a lot, they may be considered great. On the other hand, somebody renounces a lot, they may be considered great. But the spiritual or devotional understanding, greatness is determined not by how much materially detached we are, but by how much spiritually attached we are. At one level, we could say that spiritual attachment will naturally lead to material detachment. But there can be exceptions in the sense that we say Pundarik Vidyanidhi lived in opulence, but still he was greatly devoted to them. So sometimes there might be a pauper who lives in, who might be greatly devoted. And there might be a wealthy person who might be greatly attached. But it could be also very opposite. The wealthy person might be detached, and the poor person might be attached. So these both, in some people or in the standard spiritual path, both will go together. There will be material detachment and there will be spiritual attachment. But sometimes apparently there is no material detachment, but still there is spiritual attachment. And sometimes there is material detachment, but there is no spiritual attachment. So if we consider the combination, if you would have a diagram with four parts in it, we could say that the materialists are materially attached and spiritually detached. The sahajiyas are materially, they are spiritually attached and materially attached. The devotees are materially detached and spiritually attached. And the mayavadis are materially detached and spiritually detached. So I'll repeat this in case it's material attachment, spiritual attachment. So material attached, spiritually attached, that is sahajiyas. Materially attached, spiritually detached, materially attached, spiritually attached is sahajiyas. Materially attached, spiritually detached, that is materialists. Then we have materially detached, spiritually attached, that is devotees. And materially detached, spiritually detached, that is mayavadis. So now what happens, why we are talking about this here is that, although sometimes a person might appear to be materially detached, but they may not be materially detached. So here when the word Mahatma is used, Viragavacharya is saying it in the sense that he's so indifferent to worldly things that even when his daughter is killing himself, he's staying equipoised. So in that sense, someone might consider him to be a Mahatma. But actually, there can be material detachment, or there can be an appearance of material detachment, not because the person is materially detached, but the person is detached from one material thing because they're so attached to another material thing. So in this case, Daksha was so attached to considerations of honor, that I have been dishonored and how dare anybody dishonor me. That even if his daughter was killing himself, it is not that he was detached, materially detached. His emotions were so caught in his prestige considerations that he felt no emotion towards his daughters. So, one of the common complaints, if you interact with Western world, I've been spending almost 7-8 months, last 2-3 years in America and Western world. So there are some conceptions about Indians in India. It's very striking. In the West, people have a very good opinion of Indians and a very low opinion of India. Indians are hardworking, responsible, talented, successful. In fact, one of my friends, or other person who came to one of my programs, is a traffic cop. So he's telling that if we catch an Indian speeding, we normally just let them off with a warning. Because Indians in general are law-abiding. So, but India people have stereotypes. India is a very unclean place. India is the land of snake charmers. It's very strange. I said, I have lived in India for more than 40 years. I don't remember seeing more than 4 snake charmers in 40 years. And to say India is a land of snake charmers. India has more software engineers than America, Europe, Australia combined together. But anyway, so one such stereotype here is of honor killings. That Indians are so conscious of honor that if in their family, if their daughter marries somebody outside their family, then these Indians, they will even kill the girl and kill the boy. Because they consider the honor more important than the life. So they are so conscious of their honor that they cut off all connection, all affection for their daughter also. Now this can happen, and this sadly speaking does happen. But if you consider the sheer population of India, as compared to that how many such incidents happen, it is infinitesimal. But there is a tendency that just now we had taken a group of about 25 youths to Vrindavan, 25 Western yogis, they are here also now. So after our trip to Vrindavan, we asked them their experience. And one of them said that he thought that India, everyone lives in slums. And that was the idea. India is a poor country. Yes. Yes, there is a poverty in India. There are so many stereotypes that come up. So, yes, now poverty, at least you could say, is understandable because a large number of people are poor. But this kind of honor killings, they happen, but they're a small, very, very small percentage. It's like suppose some kind of caste violence happens in somewhere in Bihar or UP. And you say, India is filled with caste violence. Well, you see Mumbai, Pune, there are so many metropolitan cities where so many times people work with each other, especially in private companies, where people don't even know each other's caste. Isn't it? So it's a stereotype. So this is, if you see, the Bhagavatam talks about, this is not an honor killing in the sense that it's not that Daksha had orchestrated the killing of his daughter, but the point is some cultures are so honor centered that all ordinary human affection also is forgotten over there. So in this case, he was not detached. He was attached, but he was attached to something material. And because of that, he became apparently detached from something material. So, prestige can be a great intoxicant. Just like when a person becomes intoxicated, the person forgets everything. Similarly, when a person becomes very conscious of prestige, prestige can be a great intoxicant which makes people forget everything else. So, a devotee from Russia was telling that at a time when there's a lot of people were getting hooked to vodka in Russia, in USSR, so they had a awareness campaign. And there was a short video clipping they had made. So there was this, the news was showing, the video was, the news was showing that the vodka prices have increased. So then a son of an alcoholic, they're sitting in the family together and he says, "Oh dad, now that the prices of alcohol, vodka have increased, will you drink less?" And his father says, "No, you will eat less." That means somebody can become so desensitized. It's not that they're so attached to their alcohol that normal human affection for their child can also be lost. Just as somebody might become attached to alcohol like that, somebody can become attached to intoxication, to prestige like that. So, yes, being so indifferent even to one's own daughter's death, that is a sign of detachment. But it is not that all detachment is desirable. There are times when we should be emotionally involved. We should be concerned. If you're not concerned, then that is a concern. If we are not concerned, sometimes it's a concern. So when Narasimhadev gets angry on seeing how Prahlad has been tormented and threatened by his father Hiranyakashipu, that anger is an ornament. That anger indicates that the Lord loves his devotees. Similarly, if devotees are blasphemed, other devotees said you should not just stay indifferent over there. Now, how we express our anger, whether it is by arguing with them or countering them or clarifying, that will vary from situation to situation. We can't just impulsively act on the anger. In fact, in this particular situation, at one level, when Shiva was offended or disrespected, for the followers of Shiva to get angry was understandable because their guru has been offended. But even anger needs to be expressed in a way that makes things better, not worse. So if somebody has spoken something wrong and we lash out at them and they lash out at us and things, we make things worse, then that anger is not solving the issue. The principle is not just get angry and go on a tirade against somebody who is offending a devotee, but rather don't be emotionally uninvolved thinking that nothing matters. We should be emotionally connected with devotees, with Krishna, and we should feel concerned, agitated, and we should take some constructive action. What that action will vary. So in that sense, in some cases detachment may be undesirable, just like the Mayavadi's detachment from Krishna is undesirable. So detachment can be undesirable, and in this case the other acharyas explained that the word Mahatma is used in a sarcastic sense, that he was such a great soul that he couldn't even see his own daughter dying. He was such a great soul that he could not see the greatness of Lord Shiva. So now we may say that we may do something wrong and we may not care. Sometimes when our vision becomes captivated by something, then we don't see other things. So you're so captivated by prestige consideration that he did not see that he was offending Shiva. But there are laws that act in nature. And we may forget gravity, but gravity won't forget us. If somebody jumps down from steps out from a 10-story building, hey, I forgot about gravity. No, we're going to crash. So like that, when he offended Lord Shiva, now the reaction came. So when the reaction came at that time, even then Daksha is disturbed. So actually what we get disturbed about also reveals what we consider as valuable. In the Mahabharata, when Draupadi is being dishonored, Vidura repeatedly warns Dhritarashtra, "Stop this calamity, otherwise your whole dynasty will be destroyed." But time and time again, Vidura goes to Dhritarashtra and Vidura does not listen. Even after the attempt to disrobe Draupadi has been baffled mystically by her robe expanding unlimitedly, still the Kaurava's evil determination doesn't stop. And then the Kauravas say, "Okay, take her to our inner chambers and she will, like a maid, sweep our floors. And at that time, Vidura tells Dhritarashtra that, O king, disaster is about to befall you now. He said, that sacrificial fire which you had lit and which you always kept lit throughout your life, that has suddenly gone off. And that shakes Dhritarashtra. What? How did the sacrificial fire get extinguished? And then he says, stop this. And then he tries to seek, he tries to mollify Draupadi by saying that, you know, I had called this match only to test the skills of the two families. And if Gandhari and I ever done any good to you, please overlook the actions of my sons. And he gives the whole kingdom back to them. Of course, Duryodhan comes and pressures him again. And then again, they have a gambling match. And at that time, everything is lost. But the point is, what causes a person an alarm also reveals what they consider as valuable. Now, what we consider as danger, what we consider as a danger, reveals what we treasure. So he did not treasure his daughter. He allowed his daughter to die. But when this disastrous omen started coming, he became extremely agitated. So his material attachment is revealed when he becomes very disturbed by all this. Now, going back to that, this point of the use of the word Mahatma, see, scripture always has to be understood in context. If you don't consider context, then the same meaning, the same words can be used to mean very different things. If you, somebody says, I love you, that has one meaning. And somebody says, I love you, and puts a question mark behind it. The whole meaning changes. And then the first is, I love you, the statement. The second is, oh, you think I love you, but I don't love you. It's a completely different meaning. So this is an example of how one punctuation can change meaning. And sometimes, if you see Sanskrit, the language becomes a little ambiguous because there are not that many punctuation marks in Sanskrit. Of course, that is a sense of its efficiency. The more punctuation marks are required, that indicates that the innate construction of the language does not have that clarity, because of which the punctuation marks are required. But the example of how punctuation can completely invert the meaning. A standard example is given in English texts. Say, for example, if there are these six words, woman without her man is incomplete. Now, a group of men and a group of women were asked to punctuate the sentence. And all the men punctuated it as woman without her man is incomplete. That means a woman is incomplete if she doesn't have a man with her. And the men punctuated it as woman apostrophe without her comma man is incomplete. So, first is that a man is incomplete without a woman. The second is woman is incomplete without a man. It's completely opposite. So, the punctuation can change the sense of something. So, punctuation is a part of the context in which a statement is being made. The context, the tone in which something is said also conveys whether you are being sarcastic. So, if somebody is very manipulative, somebody is very cunning, somebody is very self-serving, and then somebody tells them, you are a genius. Now, you are a genius. Hey, you are being sarcastic, isn't it? So, initially we think, oh, I am a genius. But somebody may say that, yeah, you are an evil person. You are an evil genius. So, we have to look at the tone in which something is spoken. Now, this is a challenge. When we hear scripture, when we read scripture, what we have is the text with us. And in the text, the tone is often not conveyed. So, this is also something very important when we study Prabhupada's books. I was with His Holiness Giriraj Maharaj. And in the West, he's writing a book on the Juhu project now. It's a magnificent book, almost 800 pages. The full biography of how the project started and how it culminated. Prabhupada wanted him to write that. Is completed. So, we have been discussing about Prabhupada's, I have been helping in some way in editing that book. So, we have been discussing various things about how the book is, how Prabhupada's mood was. And he said that, for example, Prabhupada sometimes seems to have made some strong statements about women being less intelligent. Now, of course, if you see the total number of statements he has made, they, as compared to that, these are not that many. If you look at the sheer number of words Prabhupada has spoken, these are relatively few, but still, they seem to be significant. Now, if he said that wherever Prabhupada said these things, he said, I went back and heard the audio recordings wherever it was available. If it's conversation which Prabhupada said, I heard the conversation. If it was a purport, relatively speaking, purport also Prabhupada has spoken a few times. I heard the dictaphone recordings of the purports. And he said, after hearing this, not once did I notice that Prabhupada had any sense of negativity, of derision, of condemnation, of minimization when he was saying these things. And he said, then it struck me, when I look at the context and understood, he said that actually Prabhupada is not saying this to women, he is saying this to men. And the idea is, Prabhupada often compares women are less intelligent and they are like children. The idea is men should become more responsible and men should take up the responsibility of taking care of women, of protecting women, of doing whatever is necessary to protect and facilitate women. So the statement is, you hear the tone and the context, the meaning becomes very different. Otherwise, it seems to be like a minimization of women, but it is a call for men to take responsibility. And unfortunately, in much of today's analysis of Prabhupada's statement, there are hardliners who use it to try to push women down to particular stereotyped roles. They say they should not be doing anything else. And others who are ultra-liberal, who are critical of our movement, they use it to say that how Prabhupada was against women, was almost misogynistic against women. Now, neither of those is true. Because Prabhupada, none of Prabhupada's female disciples, I've talked with many of them, none of them said that they felt that Prabhupada discouraged or minimized them in any way. So, if you just look at the statement in isolation, without considering the context, the tone, you can say, you know, he's so critical. He's so critical of women. You know, in fact, this can become a big issue. Now, if we see, Prabhupada has made some statements about Negroes. Now, the word Negro itself has become like an untouchable word today. You cannot use that word. Now, if you consider thousands and thousands of words that Prabhupada has spoken, the word Negro is Prabhupada hardly ever uses the word. And Prabhupada actually was the first person to make an African American into a prominent leader in our movement. And our movement is a person has got African American gurus also. So there's no discrimination. But if you just look at Prabhupada's statements, especially if you go on Vedavyas and just search for the word Negro, then such statements come up that they completely give a very racist understanding of Prabhupada. So in fact, now the devotees are working so that if anybody, the statements are such that, I talk with leaders from South Africa and they said that those statements come out, our movement can get banned in Africa. So they are now trying to do it in such a way that if somebody logs into Vedabase and we can find out they're logging in from Africa, then we block out all the search for Negro over there. It's difficult to do that, but it's possible with technology. So my point is that decontextualize. So what happens when you do a search? Then we just look for those statements. And, hey, this is like this, this is like this, this is like this. So that we are not looking at the context. Even if we look at one sentence before, one sentence after, this reading one sentence before and one sentence after is not the context. It is actually to understand the context, you have to read the whole, read Prabhupada systematically. Otherwise, we can misunderstand. So context is critical for comprehending content. And especially in today's world, where we have sound bites. Now, sound bites can be taken and they can be circulated. So somebody can just take one sound bite from some talk and circulate on social media. This person is like this, this person like this, see, this person is doing this. It can become very... So today is the age of decontextualized communication. And it can be very, very dangerous. But in general, semantics, the study of meaning requires understanding context. And there is tone, as I said, which also conveys us, which is a part of the context. And of course, there are figures of speech. Sometimes it's spoken, something is spoken in a rhetorical way. So Prabhupada also had a great sense of humor. And because of his sense of humor, sometimes he would make certain statements
which were not meant to be taken literally. Prabhupada was just making them in a lighter way. But sometimes those taken statements are taken literally. And then we end up misunderstanding or misconstruing what Prabhupada said. So this purport helps us see how the context is so important for us to make sense of the word that is being used. And when we consider the context properly, then we can comprehend the content properly, and then we can apply it properly. So for us, when we study or share scripture, it is important that we carefully consider that, I conclude this point, that detachment in speaking doesn't mean that you just speak whatever you want and be detached from that. Not like that. Detachment in speaking means to give up our attachment to what we think we are saying and to become open to understand what others are hearing. That is detachment in speaking. It means what I am saying, we think we are saying something, but we may be actually saying something else and others may be hearing something else. So detachment in speaking means to give up our conception of what we are saying and to become open to understand what others are hearing. When we learn this, then we actually become responsible in our speaking. And when we become responsible in our speaking, then we can get the response that we desire, that Krishna's message deserves. Otherwise, we can speak in a way that will alienate a lot of people. Sometimes some devotees are very proud. Not proud in a bad sense, but say, I made so many people into devotees. So many souls came to Krishna because of me. We have a track of that. Okay, so if somebody takes initiation, somebody starts coming to the temple, somebody starts connecting regularly, chanting, we can have a track of that. But you know, we have no track of how many souls did not come to Krishna because of me. Because of the way I spoke, because of the way I conducted myself, because of these things. So there might be so many casualties who we never come to know about. So detachment in speech means that we take responsibility not just for what we speak, but for also for trying as much as possible to ensure that what we speak is heard and understood properly. Then we'll find that Krishna consciousness attractiveness will be attractive for people. And then they will be more and more attracted towards Krishna. So I'll summarize. I spoke today on the theme of appreciating the nuances of communication. And I talked about how the Bhagavad Gita itself has many non-literal usages. I talked about three things: Yani Shasarva Bhutana, Kim Asita Vrajeta Kim, and Atmanasha. Three examples. So here the word Mahatma is used also in a non-literal sense. The word Mahatma itself is non-literal because the soul is Anu, is not Maha. But Mahatma refers, non-literal refers to that it's the conceptions, the values of the soul, not the size of the soul. And then we talked about how here the word Mahatma doesn't refer to a great soul in the right sense. It is sarcastic. Because some people may perceive of greatness in terms of material detachment, which is okay, but a more holistic understanding of greatness is in terms of spiritual attachment. Attachment to great values, attachment to the one who is the greatest value, that is Krishna. We talked about those four levels of material attachment and material detachment. And when some people appear to be materially detached also, they may actually not be materially detached. They may just be detached from one thing because they are attached to something else. It's like an alcoholic may be detached from whether their children are eating or not. That's not because they have detachment, that's because they are so maddened by attachment to alcohol. Similarly, Daksha was indifferent to his daughter's dying, killing herself, because he was so infatuated with prestige. Prestige is also an intoxicant. And yet, when this disaster started coming upon him, he started becoming agitated. So what we consider as a danger reveals what we treasure. So Dhritarashtra did not consider disrobing Draupadi and angering the Pandavas as a danger, but his extinguishing of the fire, that he considered a great danger, so a sacrificial fire. And then I talked about how we need context to comprehend content. So one part of context would be the punctuation. Punctuation, if it is put in a, if it is put in a particular way, one meaning can come. Another way, entirely opposite meaning can come. And languages that have less punctuations, they are at one level efficient in conveying meaning through the words itself without relying on punctuation marks. But to people who are used to punctuation marks, they, for them, those languages may seem to feature a lot of ambiguity. And and then I talked about how if we decontextualize Prabhupada's statements, the tone is also part of the context. So spoken words have a particular tone to them, and that is not, it is not always reflected, sometimes never reflected in the transcript of those tones. So what Prabhupada says about women is actually a call for men to take responsibility, not a mandate to deny women opportunity. And similarly, Prabhupada's statements about certain other contexts, other situations also, things also, decontextualized can be misunderstood. And that's, and I concluded by, if we want to be effective in our outreach, we need to become responsible in our speaking. And becoming responsible in our speaking means that we take the responsibility not only to take check what we speak, but we detach ourselves from what we think we are saying, and we open ourselves to understanding what people are hearing. Otherwise, by our speaking, we may be actually bringing a few souls to Krishna, but we may be sending a lot of souls away from Krishna also. When we learn to be responsible in our speaking, then Krishna's attractiveness will manifest through us, through our words and actions, and many, many souls will be attracted to Krishna. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. So, do we have time for questions?
Yeah.
Okay.
Hare Krishna. Thank you once again for another very wonderful class. My question was in the context of use of non-literals, analogies, similes in the Vedic narrative, because we see that it has created a scope for a lot of potential misunderstanding. How much are we to use those in our own narratives in the modern world today, in this particular age? Because it seems like in the end of the class, you actually mentioned how we, as a communicator, we need to be conscious also of how the other person could potentially interpret our statements. So, in our own narratives, how conscious do we have to be, and why then do the Vedic culture promote this kind of narratives? Because we see even in the modern spiritual world, which I like to call this kind of confusing Zen talk, seems to be like a very spiritually appealing way of presentation. So how do we learn to be faithful to the Vedic narrative and the style of Vedic narration and still be presentable and in the, communicate the right meaning?
Yeah. So since non-literal interpretations are popular in today's world, and spirituality often is filled with Zen-like things which are, can be interpreted in multiple ways, and that creates confusion. So how much should we use it, and why do the Vedic scriptures contain it at all? It's not that inherently multiple interpretations are bad. In fact, if something can be understood in multiple ways, that can also convey the richness of the writer's thoughts or the richness of the text itself. So, for example, one reason why poetry is very attractive to some people is that as compared to prose, poetry can have multiple layers of meaning. Even prose can have, but poetry all the more so. Poetry conveys things in an indirect way. And the opportunity for using alankars, for ornaments, literary devices, figures of speech is much, much more in poetry. So, so this is a feature of language itself. And we cannot minimize it or deny it. It's just a fact of language, and it conveys the richness of language. In fact, according to linguists, it's almost like every 5 to 10 sentences we use a metaphor. So that's why it is, metaphors are just a part of our life, and metaphors are one example of non-literal usage. So when they are present in scripture, they're just reflecting the reality of how we communicate, and they're also reflecting the richness of scriptural communication, of scriptural wisdom basically. As far as multiple interpretations being concerned, yes, there is a modern school of thought called deconstructionism. Now, deconstructionists argue that actually a text has no inherent meaning. And is it the entire meaning of the text depends on who is reading it and how they are interpreting it. Now, of course, the standard refutation of this is, well, your assertion itself has no inherent meaning. Isn't it? When you say that, the sentences have no inherent meaning, they say this sentence has no inherent meaning. So that is an extreme, and there is a strong reaction to that, response to that also, that deconstructionism is being opposed, not just by theists, but even atheists, because atheists also want to categorically say that God doesn't exist. So if the state statements have no inherent meaning, then it's almost like nobody can have any philosophy at all. So that is the extreme. Now what happens with respect to spirituality? Because for many people, spirituality cannot have any empirical evidence like what you can have from science. So that's why spirituality is often the domain of greater vagueness. So most postmodern people are very interested in what is called as pragmatic spirituality. Pragmatic spirituality is not philosophical spirituality. Philosophical spirituality is what is the nature of reality. Pragmatic spirituality is what works for me. So whatever works for me, I'm fine with that. And then if it has some logical, intellectual understanding, that's an add-on. But that's not the basis. So I'll say that about 5-7 years ago, I was very, very categorical about right and wrong interpretation of scripture. But now I've understood that it sometimes even a wrong interpretation of scripture can create interest in scripture among the audience. And then people are more open to right understanding of scripture. When I was editing Radha Maharaj's journey within book, so there's a section where Maharaj talks about a spiritual master. And then I had suggested that Maharaj, you can add something a little more clear over here, that one should not approach a spiritual master like a shopper, one should be a seeker. Not that I like this, I like that, I like that. You should be like a seeker. So Maharaj told me, I cannot write that. Because most of the people who will be reading this book will be reading it because they are shoppers. That shopper means, okay, I like, try for this a little from here, try a little from there, try a little from there. And then whatever makes sense, I take that. So I would say that when the Siddhant is to be conveyed, we have to be clear that this is right Siddhant, this is wrong Siddhant. But for people who come to a particular path, the Siddhant, the philosophy is only one part. And that too a very small part of why they come to a particular path. It is because what kind of people they meet. It is because of what kind of atmosphere they perceive. It is because of what kind of experiences they have. And even before they consider a path, they actually have certain preconceptions about that path. And because of that itself, they decide either to approach that path or not approach that path. So at one level, yoga in today's world has been completely misrepresented, you could say. Traditionally, yoga was practiced by male ascetics for renouncing the world. Now, most yoga practitioners are females who want to make their body more healthy and attractive so that they can attract attention in the world. So you could say the purpose of yoga is not only different, but it's opposite. But in spite of that, whatever reason they practice yoga, that has created some appreciation for yoga, and that has created some openness for the tradition from which yoga has come. And that's how they have come towards spirituality. So I would say that there are forums for systematic philosophical education, at that time clear-cut understanding of Siddhanta is important. But even if because of some non-literal meaning, somebody comes, gets an appreciation for a text, and that is also good. Because at least they become a little interested, they become a little open. And because most people are interested in pragmatic spirituality, not philosophical spirituality, so even if they get a non-literal meaning of the text, and later on they are told a literal meaning, they are quite open to giving up the non-literal meaning and accepting the literal meaning. But if that non-literal meaning was never there at all, then they might never even be interested in the text. So I would say that there is a forum for clear-cut emphasis on Siddhant, correct and wrong understanding, And there is a time for just encouraging people to become interested in spiritual wisdom. And if by that gradually they come, then eventually they'll get a clear understanding. So certainly we cannot have unlimited interpretations of scriptural text, but at the same time, if we don't have the resources to police society at all. If somebody is giving a interpretation that is, you could say, wrong, but then what can we do about it? Do we have the resources to go about refuting it? And how many wrong things can we refute? So if something makes people favorable to scripture, that is good. They may not necessarily all of them come towards Krishna because of that, but at least they get a favorable conception. And it is also true that not everybody is likely to practice bhakti sadhana as seriously as we would like them to. It's manushyanam sahasreshu. So it's better that we have a pyramid where there are some people are serious practitioners and others are favorable, instead of some people practicing seriously and other people thinking that this is just crazy. What are these people doing? Like I was at a conference, I was at an interfaith meeting, and this Christian pastor was telling me that how the situation was about 15 years ago and now it is now. So he said that he had done a survey. It's like sometimes we have icebreakers. So in his pastoral meeting, he says, what is the craziest thing you have ever heard in your life? So he said, three of my congregation members came and told me that Hare Krishna approached me and told me on the street that Krishna is God. This is the craziest thing we have heard in our life. So that is where people are coming from. So now at least people don't think like that. The Krishna bhakti tradition is recognized as a valid tradition within Hinduism. And that way things are changing. Okay, thank you. Yes, we have time? Last question?
Oh.
Okay. So, thank you very much. La Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki, Gaur Premanande.
Very relevant answer, Rohit. Thank you so much.